was almost a year before I could hardly get back. The sun was shining bright. I said, Esther, what's wrong with the sun? It's not shining very bright anymore. Esther said, dang, the sun's shining really bright. I said, and you know, that's how bright it was in heaven. It looks like, it looks almost night here compared to that. But anyway, what I'm trying to tell you, when you and I have fellowship with heaven, Father, our Heavenly Father feels the same way that I'm trying to tell you right now. If you understood that Heavenly Father has such a loving desire to have fellowship with you, He wants to have a loving fellowship with you. When you get up in the morning, I believe the Lord would say, my children is waking up. And I think right now we need another wake-up call. I think we need another wake-up call now. And Lord, bring that wake-up call. It's time for us to wake. And right now, I am going to try to stir you up this morning to really get you to understand that we need to wake to really who we are. Do you really know who you are? Do you honestly know who you are? Do you know what not your title, but what you are? Your title may not match you. But I tell you one thing, if you got your relationship with God, I don't care who you are, it's going to work. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit here today. I am passing through. That's God's word I'm passing through. I am coming through the land of Egypt. It's not a death angel coming through, I'm coming through. I'm coming through the land of Egypt. And I want to set some rules and regulations that you need to understand. Do exactly what I tell you to, because when I pass through, something great is going to happen. You know, folks, I believe we are getting ready to see some of the greatest moves of the Spirit of God we've ever seen. But are people ready for it? Are we ready when the Lord moves through? And when God was about to come through Egypt and do some things, He set forth, do this, do it this way. Now, let me read it to you. If you have your Bibles, would you open in Exodus chapter 12? Exodus chapter 12, and I want you to really notice these words. God is giving not an idea, He's giving commandment. This is the way I want it done. Now I'm coming through. If you want my blessings on you, if you want to bypass your trouble, follow directions completely. Exodus chapter 12, beginning verse 11. Thus shall you eat. Now, he's talking about killing a lamb and so forth, and all that's supposed to be done now. And thus shall you eat it, with your loins girded. Did you get that? Yes. Now, folks, when you eat this lamb, have your loins girded. If you don't have your loins girded, you are not going to get what I got for you. Your shoes on your feet. Get your shoes on your feet. Do you have your shoes on your feet? Do you really have the staff in your hand? Do you have your staff in your hand? Now what I want you to do is eat it in haste. Eat that lamb in haste. Now remember, I said eat it in haste. I am coming through, and you don't know exactly when, how, what. It's the same thing when the Lord is coming back again. You better get your feet right with God. You better get everything right with God, because He's coming again. Verse 12 says, and I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and I will smite all the firstborn of the land of Egypt, both men and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. I am going to be judging. I will pass through the land this night. I'm coming through tonight. If you're ready, okay. If you're not ready, it's still too late. I am passing through the land, not a death angel, as we've been taught ever since we were little children, that a death angel came through. The Lord said, I'm coming through, not a death angel. I'm coming through the land. And the blood shall be for a token upon your houses where you are. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. Now that Passover day is not going to bypass you. It means I will not judge you. You know, folks, the most dangerous thing in this whole world is the most profitable and wonderful thing we have can be the most dangerous. There is nothing in the whole world that's more dangerous than mishandling the blood of Jesus. It's nothing any more dangerous than taking communion with your mind wandering hither and thither and not getting your mind on what is really happening. That's an extreme dangerous situation, and that's why it's found in the 11th chapter of verse Corinthians about how important that is. And for this cause many awaken sickly among you and many sleep. Because you didn't understand the blood. The blood is a wonderful thing. It's life-giving, but it's also death-giving to those people that will not do it right. Do not misunderstand the blood. To handle that blood very, very carefully. Handle that blood very carefully. Whether it's your blood, somebody else's blood, blood is very important. That's why you do not kill another individual. That blood is going to cry out against you. When Cain killed Abel, that blood started crying out of the land. It started crying out, somebody killed me. Somebody killed me. And God heard it. Cain, what did you do? Your brothers. Blood is crying out. It's because of Jesus' blood that all the innocent blood of this land has kept us from getting torn to pieces. This land is saturated with innocent blood. It's only the blood of the Lord that can keep us from having major problems. Because the blood of the Lord speaks pardon. The blood of the Lord speaks forgiveness. The blood of the Lord remembers not the evil, but the good. Therefore, you make sure when I pass through the land that you did exactly what I told you. When I come through, make sure you follow directions. Don't do it haphazard. Don't do it like the Americans do. Well, that's good enough. No, it isn't good enough. It is not good enough. You did exactly the way I told you to do, which I emphasize just a little bit later. And this shall be in the year memorial, and you should keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it a feast and ordinance forever. That is why we take communion and we give a symbol of we have the blood and the bread in focus. And I'll tell you what, when you realize that it's not good enough, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the way thereof is the way of death. Now let me show you something. I'm going to try to emphasize that in just a little bit. Now what we'll do is we go just a little bit further here in the 12th chapter and go to verse 22. And now this is a repeat, but I want you to notice how very, very important this is. And you should take a bunch of hyssop, use what? Hyssop. I don't have any hyssop. I think I'll just use a cloth. I got some old clothes here. I just dip them in, but I said hyssop. Not tails. I said hyssop. And I said dip it. I did not say dip it. No, dip it. Follow directions to the letter. I'm passing through this land tonight. If you're ready, okay. If you're not, okay. Here's what you do. Take that blood that's in the basin and strike it. On the little, strike it. The Lord Jesus was smitten. Strike that blood on the letters and the two posts with the blood that is in the basin, and none of you follow directions very carefully. None of you should go out of the door of your house the morning. Oh, I forgot something. All I'm going to do is just step outside the door. I forgot to get something. I won't take it along with me to Egypt. To Canaan land or whatever. Too late. The Lord will smite you. When I see that blood has to be put exactly where I told you to put it. That blood has to be exactly put on the way I told you to. If you didn't use, you say, well, I don't have hyssop. Well, just use a cloth or something. No, I said hyssop. Well, but our God is a merciful God. I mean, He understands. That's the problem. He does understand. Folks, we've got to a Christianity that's called grace has turned into disgrace. We really have a religion that has become a disgrace to the human race. It really has. Because we feel like we can violate things. Well, God is forgiving. Oh, wait a little. The Lord said, for the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when I see the blood upon the lentils, when I see the blood on the lentil, did you put it exactly where I told you to? When I see it on the lentil and the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door. If it's not there, somebody's going to suffer the consequences. If it isn't done exactly the way I said, the blood is very, very, very important. Follow the directions the way I told you. And folks, I tell you what, this is one thing you and I need to understand and know, that you can play with some things, but you can't play with the blood. I don't care. When you talk about blood, you better handle that thing with care. Especially when you're talking about the blood of Jesus. It is not a haphazard communion time that maybe haphazardly take communion and we just kind of go through it. No, folks, I'm trying to get across to you. The Lord spoke to me recently and He said, I've divided your church. Now I'm getting ready to move. And there's going to be a great move of the Spirit if you can get my people talking to get right with me. If you can talk my people into doing what I told you to do, that I will pass through, not to destroy, I'm passing through to bring great revival and great manifestation in the power of God. And I said, come on, come on, come on. But He said, the thing that I got trouble with, now this is the Lord speaking, whether you believe the Lord speaks to me or not, you find out what I'll tell you. He said, what the trouble is, I can't get my people to do anything more than 3 days. At the third day, that's it. I mean, you know, you can have 3 days of meetings, but after that, I mean, we get tired. It's because you never let me move. Now let me show you something. I just got to thank them. A preacher just the other day, it just came to me. And he said, you know, there's a church up here. They decide to have meetings. And he said, the people were so hungry to get God in that position. And they got really hungry for God. So does Abraham and the wicked meetings. They had a wicked meetings. And he said, every service, everybody was there. Everybody was there, is what he said. The next week, we went on next week, everybody was there. They're on the third week right now, he said, and everybody is at church every night. It doesn't make any difference what their jobs is. It doesn't matter what anything else is. The most important thing is everybody is there. You know, that's what you call God moving through the line. And I tell you, the Lord's coming through the line. Are we going to be ready? Will he find the blood on the letters and the two posts? Or is he going to bypass us? And we won't have a revival. Well, I mean, 3 days is good enough, not with the Lord. It may not be good enough. And the Lord asked me a question. I mean, it floored me. It really did. It threw me off guard. He said, you ate the same amount of time that you'll have church, would you be able to be a healthy Christian? He said, my word is more important than all your food you can ever eat because it's eternal. He said, I'm going to start putting the desire back in your people to have services. And when you have revival, I said, when you have revival. Now, what he told me, when you have revival, everybody will know it. It's going to something up, but your people are not ready for it yet. But you're getting ready for it because your prayer meetings are starting to open the door for me. Now, get courage here. Don't get all the damnation now. And I'll tell you what, the Lord is calling me to... I'm going to come through. Don't let me bypass you. You know, the Lord says to me, as many a time I've gone through an area and I look for a church where I could have an outpouring of the Spirit. That church didn't qualify, so go to the next one. That don't qualify, go to the next one. That don't qualify, go to the next one. So now I have none. Nobody wants an outpouring of the Spirit. They talk about it, but they're not ready for it. So I bypass them. Now, I tell you what. Those of you that have been around me for a long time know that there's a time the Lord said to me, I want you to have healing meetings. And so I had healing meetings. And I tell you what. I couldn't figure out how you're going to have healing meetings and who's going to come and all kinds of things. And then those things became very successful. In fact, the matter is because I thought of direction. I had the thought of direction. The Lord had me get up every morning at 2 o'clock and go out and pray for a long time. 2 o'clock in the morning, that's still my prayer time. I don't care if it's daylight saving time or otherwise, it's still 2 o'clock at the time of the cross. And I get a great journey to pray. And I tell you what, the Lord is getting ready to do something. Are we ready or are we even hungry enough to get it? And I'll tell you what, that frightens me and scares me. I said, oh Lord, don't pass this by. That song that we sing sometimes, I think up here, pass me not, O gentle Savior. Don't pass me. I want what you got for me. I got what you want for me. But suppose you're busy. Suppose you got too much on the go, and I want to do something, but Lord, if you could just hold off a little while. We're kind of busy right now, so maybe you come back a little later. You know, no, I won't be back because you missed that much. And I'll tell you what, you know what we got to do is beware of what Amos wrote. In Amos chapter 8, he said in verse 5, the people said, when will the new moon be gone that we may sell corn, and the Sabbath that we may set forth wheat, making the of it small, and a shackle great, and falsifying the bounds of deceit? You know what will happen? If you do not do what God says do, you'll do it deceitfully. You'll do it deceitfully. You won't do what he tells you to do. If you understand, though, how many of y'all realize that God said to the children of Israel, you teach your children when you get up in the morning, when you go to bed at night, you talk about the things of God. When you're in the house, when you're laying down, when you're rising up, oh, come on, that's only a symbol. He's not really meaning do that. He's not saying do that. Wait a little. Follow direction, folks. Did you put the blood up where I told you on that door? Well, I didn't exactly put it at, you know, I'm kind of short. I couldn't get that up there. I'm kind of short. I couldn't know how to reach it. Well, I said the blood's got to be on that door, right? You got a step stool? You ought to, you folks. The Lord is saying to me, the day is coming again where I am not going to allow people to do as they want to do. This thing is coming to an end. He said, I'm going to bring a revival, and your church is bigger than you ever expected, but it's going to have to be some cooperation.
That's right.
I said, Lord, get those of us who can.
Jesus.
I don't want to bypass anybody.
Amen.
Boy, I'll tell you what. I have seen the Lord bringing us together in unity like we've never been before. Right now, Pennsylvania and Kansas and Virginia are working close together, real close together. And we got Reuben back here again, which he won't take over this church at leadership, but he said, that's your church, you do that. But anyway, he works with me real close. Him and I don't do anything without telling each other about it. So, I'll tell you what, folks. Lord told me, when I pass through, those are the ready, I'll spare those that's not, I won't. That's the reason you have to go to this again. If you're so busy with your stuff, how many of y'all remember years ago, I got a prophetic word years ago. In fact, I had actually forgotten about it. For some reason, I kind of forgot about it. The Lord spoke to me years ago, and he said, there's three gods that's rising up in your people. Number one is horses. Horses have become gods. Number two is dogs. Dogs became gods. Number three, cats will become gods. Those are the three gods that's going to affect your people. They said that many years ago. Those three gods are going to affect your people. The other day, now he brought that back up and he said, now the fourth one is going to be teddy bears, dolls, and so forth. And listen to this. There'll be many, many, many people will start going to bed with Barbie dolls. Even older people will go to bed with dolls and teddy bears and stuffed animals. They'll become their gods. That will be their comfort. When he said that, it scared me. I said, holy. He said, yeah, you'd be surprised how many old people go to bed with teddy bears. I couldn't hardly believe what I was hearing. But have we lost it, or am I off? did I hear from somewhere else, or is this true? I can't verify, because I've been running nursing on to find out how many dolls I got and all kind of stuff. But I do know this much, folks. The Lord is passing through, and he's going to send a revival. I'm saying he's going to send a revival, a transformation, a change of heart. He's going to change your appetite. He's going to make you hungry for the things of God. Are you ready? Are you really ready? Do you have the blood applied at the right place? Did you really follow the instruction? Did you put that blood where I told you about on the two side first? Did you really do that? Are you sure you got it done right? I'm passing through tonight. Are you sure you got it right? But it really, I forgot something outside the door. All I'm going to do is open the door and just get it. No, don't go out of that door. Well, God's not that critical. Surely God's merciful. Well, let me ask you something. How merciful is God? God told Moses one time to speak to a rock, and water come out. He spoke to the rock, and the water came out. Another time he said to Moses, Moses, speak to that rock, that water comes out. Moses, being angry, the meekest man on earth, the meekest man that ever lived, got angry, upset at the hard-heartedness, stiff-neckedness of the children of Israel, got mad, and all he did was just hit it. That's all he did. His mistake. I know, Lord, I'm sorry. Moses, you can't go to the land of Canaan. You lost it. You can't go to the land of Canaan. You didn't do what I told you to do. But our modern day philosophy says, oh, it isn't that important. It was to Moses. Moses said, Lord, would you change your mind? God said, no, I'll let you go up on the God of a good land, but you won't be able to go over. Aren't you a forgiving God? Aren't you really a forgiving God? I mean, after all, we all make mistakes. We all make mistakes. That's what I'm told. I'm told we all make mistakes, but Moses suffered severely for that. In fact, the only person at Moses' funeral was God himself. Nobody else was at his funeral beside God. And God buried him. Nobody knows where he's buried as of today. Does it matter? Children, does it really matter if you obey your parents or not? Does it really matter? Does it really matter? Exodus 23, beginning of verse 20, it says, now God sent the people out, and he said, I'm sending an angel before you to keep you in the way and to bring you to the place I prepared. Where I told you to go, I am sending the angel ahead of you to prepare a way. Now, wait a little, folks. Beware, beware, beware. I'm sending an angel ahead of you, but beware of him and obey his voice. Provoke him not, for he will not pardon you. He'll not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him. Don't tamper with that angel. I'm sending that angel before you. Make sure you follow his direction. If you disobey him, you're going to have major problems. You may wonder why I was preaching this morning, because the Lord had me to bring this to you. You shall indeed obey his voice. And do all that I speak, then I'll be an enemy to the enemy and adversary. Remember, don't provoke that angel. He can't forgive you. He won't forgive you. You say, well, now wait a little. We're Americans. Don't you understand? Don't you understand? We have a monopoly on heaven. We can do as we please. Yeah, that's the reason the judgment of God is coming upon America. And not everyone that saith to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. But he that doth the will of my Father which is in heaven, that's the one that's going to make it. The one that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Then he says, for many shall come to that day. Many shall say to me that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name been many wonderful things. Remember, Lord, we did it in your name. Remember, Lord, we did it in your name. We even said in the name of Jesus. And now you're saying that you won't accept us. Many shall say unto me that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out devils. In thy name done many wonderful works. And I'll say to them, depart from me. I don't even know you. I never had a relationship with you. I have no relationship with you. Get out of here. Oh, Lord. Do you remember? In anger, in wrath, have mercy, Lord. It's too late now. This is a pretty serious thing I'm talking about, folks. Many is not a few. The way I understand many is many. I will profess to them that said, I'm casting out devils in your name. I did this in your name. I did that in your name. I've been a Christian. I've been doing good things. And I'll declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Folks, listen. The Lord said to me, many churches that's doing all kind of things, like it looks like they're casting out devils and what have you, they're not right with me at all. They're doing things with a false, they have falsehood, and that whole situation is false. And because it's false, I will pour out my wrath upon them when comes the time. But not everyone that said, Lord, Lord, oh, a lot of people say that. You know what? That's a scary thing. I'll tell you, I was so scared. I'll tell you, folks, when the Lord got down to me the other day, I was so frightened that I was actually shook. I was frightened. I said, is it that serious? Is it that serious? He said, no, it's worse than that. Well, but what went wrong? What went wrong? I thought we were right. I really thought we was right. In fact, we were casting out devils. We was doing all kind of things. We thought we were right, but you were not. Remember? 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Beginning verse 27, wherefore whosoever eateth this bread, drinketh this cup unworthily, and eateth and drinketh damnation to himself. The next time we have communion, think it like the Lord is passing by. He's looking at us. Do you understand what that cup is about? Are you taking that communion with a appreciation and praise and honor and glory to the blood? Are you really getting it? See, I know your heart. You take that cup up and you drink it. Well, yes, the blood of Jesus. I mean, yeah, I know what it is. I mean, I know the broken body. I mean, yeah, I know it. That's about all the mess to. Do you really have an understanding of what I'm saying? The Lord said, I'm requiring things of people. What doth the Lord thy God require thee? With the love, justice, mercy, and walk humbly before thy God. Requirement. Does he really mean that? Does he really mean the Lord God requires of me to walk humbly before my God? Or I'm humble. I mean, I think I'm humble. I mean, I don't know that I'm proud. I mean, I think I'm humble. Eat and drink of damnation himself, not discerning the Lord's blood. That's for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Many die prematurely. Many people are in their graves today that should not be in the grave today because they did not follow direction. When you take that cup in your hand and drink it, this represents the blood of Jesus. Don't you tamper with the blood of Jesus. I'll tell you, folks, I'm so scared. I don't know that I ever got that scared in my life. When the Lord spoke to me, he spoke to me many times, but not this bad. I mean, I was scared. He said there's a lot of things in the scripture it's become nothing to you. It's just, well, yeah, you know, we know that, but no, you don't know it. And I'm going to bring some up here in a little bit. I'm going to start, I'm sorry. And notice this. The church in Laodicea was a pretty good old church. I mean, that's a pretty good church, I mean. But let's see what God said about it. So if you find Revelation chapter 3, and let's see what God got to say about this great church of the Laodiceans. This saying saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness and beginning of creation of God, I know thy works. Did you know, folks, God knows your works. He knows exactly where this church is going and what's going to happen. I notice thy works, that you're neither cold nor hot. My word that you were cold or hot, I don't want to look warm. It's going to, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. I'm going to vomit you up. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods, not needing nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I didn't know he was that bad a shape. I thought we had a good church. I mean, things have gone good here. Lord, what are you talking about? I mean, everything going on good. God said, in my love, I chasten. I'll correct the church if I can. You know what, folks? I mean, I trembled. You talk about trembling. I trembled when the Lord got done talking to me the other day. You know, Ecclesiastes 12, verses 13 and 14 says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. The whole matter. Let's get the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God to keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. That's your duty. Well, but we don't believe in the fear of God. I mean, somebody came to me and told me in a very hateful way, he said, you're teaching the fear of God. You don't fear God. God is a loving God. You don't fear God. You know, that God rebuked me perpetually, and soon he was in the grave. I mean, soon he was in the grave. Let's not temper with God's stuff, folks. Let's not temper with it. Amen. Let's hear the conclusion. No matter, keep God's commandments. That's the duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing. All those secret things you've done, whether good or bad, whether good or evil, he's going to bring them to judgment. How many of you could ever say, Philippians 2:12 says, wherefore, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, not in my presence only, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Yeah. How many of us could say we worked out our salvation with fear and trembling?
Oh, God.
Do you know anybody that said, you know, when I was praying after I got saved and I said, Lord, is there anything in my life that's not right? Trembling. Fear and trembling. It's almost a historical fact. I mean, what are you talking about? We're Americans. I'm talking to Christians, not Americans.
Yes.
I'm talking to Christians. It is written, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he's near. Let the wicked forsake his ways and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Okay, Lord, Isaiah 55:6-7 says that. We're going to change, folks, we're going to change. We're going to say, Lord, did we do it right? If the Lord is the pastor this night, did you put that blood where I told you to put it? Did you use the tools I told you to use? Did you use hyssop? Well, we didn't have any hyssop. Did you use the right kind of lamb? Was the lamb without spot and blemish? Well, we had one that was getting ready to die, and we thought we'd just kill that, and because it ain't worth much anyway, so I was the best. I want the best. I'm not taking things with the best. I'm going to give you the best that I have, my son Jesus. Don't temper with that blood. That represents my son. All the sins of the world will be on my son. Don't temper with it. The Lord is passing through. Are we ready? In the book of Acts, chapter 14, verse 22, it says, the apostles went through, the disciples went through the land, and they exhorted the people to continue in the faith, that we must do much tribulation in the kingdom of God. How many churches have you been in that actually said, really mean it, that it's too much tribulation that I'm going to be able to make it to heaven? Oh, our God is a merciful God. Our God is so loving. You know, folks, I couldn't have preached this message before the Lord told me. I couldn't give you this message to the others. They would have rejected it. But your people, some of them would accept it.
That's right.
Yeah. I'll tell you what. Well, yeah, I'm going through a lot of tribulations. I mean, oh my, you know, I'm really going through tribulation. But what do you meet with tribulation? Have you really had anybody downright just say, if you don't change your way, I'm going to kill you? Keep the heart with all diligence, for that is the issues of life.
Yes.
Heart. Keep the heart with all diligence. I mean, make sure that everything in your heart is right. Keep that heart, folks. Keep that heart. Is your heart right with God? Is your heart full of love? Or is your heart full of wanting to be seen and heard? Suppose the Lord called us and didn't say a word to us except that we're supposed to have meetings, and all of a sudden it kept on going and going and going. I had a preacher years ago that called me. That's been a long time ago, but he said, we're supposed to have a week of meetings about in Michigan. Right now, Dan, we've been at this thing for 6 months and we're still going. We don't have time for that, Lord, bypass us. I'll tell you something. I know this to be a fact now. Years ago, the Lord came through the land and people got saved, and I mean completely saved. People actually, they closed down the taverns because people wouldn't go to taverns anymore. And what would they say about you if you closed the tavern down because everybody got saved, you know? You know what? I know of a preacher. At one time he said, the hospital notified me and said, what is going on? There's nobody coming to the hospital anymore. He said, everybody's getting saved. Getting healed. You know, right here in Harrisonburg, a surgeon called me. He said, could I talk to you? I said, yeah. He said, look, I wonder how many times I've had an operation and they come to you after came to me and you laid hands on the guy healed. So I lost the operation. And he said, that's all right, but tell your people to come to you first. Not to come to me first, come to you first. They have a theory that you need to go see the doctor first so you know when you get healed. He said, tell them to come to you first. You know what? That doctor, that same doctor, asked me to come to his office and pray for his patients that he couldn't get healed. Right here in Ashenburg. You know, the very first person that got healed was him. The Lord didn't ask him whether he'd mind the spirit moving. I touched that doctor, that surgeon, I touched him with my right hand, and Yummy was there. I know how far that doctor went, but he flew across the floor. I mean, when I touched him, he flew across and hit that sofa. Healed. Get up healed. Every one of his patients were healed that night, every one of them. Mighty move of God right in the doctor's office. And the Lord said to me, just as clear as I'm talking to you, I'm going to, if your church can't have me, then I'll go somewhere else with you. And you can do it somewhere else, not in the church, get somewhere else. Because the church don't want to change your philosophy. So I go to the doctor's office. The Lord is getting ready to do something. Are we ready? Are we ready? Do we really want him to mess up our plans? I mean, you know, I'm planning right now to go to a certain place to eat, which I always did enjoy going there. They fed me free there already, and they put me overnight there free of charge in a very expensive place and so forth, and took care of me, and I'm planning to go down there again. In fact, just before Esther died, they asked me to come and spend, that Esther and I come and spend a couple of days there at motel and eat at that place on them. And you know what? Suppose the very day we plan to go down there to eat at this great eating place, the Lord said, no, instead of eating, you're going to eat my word and you're going to go pray. Lord, just a minute. Let's talk this thing up a little bit. Could we just change the date a little? I mean, can't we just change the date? I mean, now, Lord, don't get too critical here. I mean, what would happen then? Suppose the Lord wanted to move here. And he says, you're not ready. First, I'm going to tell you something. The Lord spoke to me as clear as he could. I want you to have the greatest revival meetings you have ever had, and you call them transformation meetings. And so I am getting ready to pour out my spirit, but your people are not ready. How long? Well, I didn't ask the Lord this, but I'm asking you. How long will it take us to get ready? Can we get ready in a month or 2 months or 3 months or 3 years or 10 years? Then it may be too late. You know, the think of this. Jude, as he's closing up, that little book of Jude, he said, when I gave all diligence to write in the year of the common salvation, it's needful for me to write to you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith. Jude, what do you mean earnestly contend for the faith? I got faith. Do you really know that your name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life? Do you really know that? Do you have the assurance of salvation? Are you really sure? You're sure. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near. Are you going somewhere, Lord? Isaiah 55:6 says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near. Don't take a chance, folks. Suppose the Lord is coming to you. He's got to bring healing and deliverances and everything else. Are you ready? We can say, oh, yeah, I'm ready. Of course, yeah, sure. Yeah, of course I'm ready. Well, Lord, you do understand that I had some plans made. I did too. I got some plans made too. But Lord, you don't understand. I got some plans made too. But if you're not going to fit in my plan, then I'm going to bypass you. The Lord is pressing through. Is he going to stop by us and give us a great revival? Is it going to? Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near. You know, Peter said in 2 Peter 1, verse 10, he said, wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your call and election sure. Make your calling and election sure with God. Make sure you do it right. Here's the reward. It says, for so an entrance shall be administered to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Lord said, there's so many things that I want to do for y'all. There's so many things I want to do for you. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 29 says, but if ye from men shall seek the Lord your God, thou shalt find him if. Thou shalt find him if. Thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. They'll be there. But Lord, you don't understand, we got it kind of different than that. I mean, we do things pretty simple, you know. I mean, we Americans, we've been able to do whatever we want to. If we want to go to church, we go to church. If we want to change churches, we can change church. We can do anything. But now I'll be getting anybody. How are we going to get the Lord to have revival? How are we going to make God have revival? How are we going to make him in our category? He's not going to. Our mold don't fit. He don't fit in our shoes. Listen to this. Isaiah 66, verse 2. For all these things hath my hand made, and all those things which he changed, saith the Lord. But B-U-T. But to this man will I look, even him that is poor and contrite in spirit,
yes,
and troubled at thy word. Trouble. God said, I'm going to look to the man and pick that Bible up and trembles. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Wait a little, hold it. You know, really, Lord, we're getting along pretty good. Just the way we are. Now, boy, the road just gets us all messed up here. Boy, I tell you what, folks, listen to this. I heard a voice from heaven saying, now salvation come to this strength in the kingdom of our God, the power of his Christ, for the accuser of our brethren that's cast down, once cast down. He accused them day and night before God, and they overcame him.
Yes.
We are overcomers. We do things right, and the devil has no chance on us. And therefore, he says, the accuser of our brethren is cast out. And he says, and they overcame that accuser of the brethren, that a word of their testimony. You know, I tell you, when somebody starts accusing me, you better have Bible to back you up, because I'm going to use the blood. The thing hit zero, but I'm going to tell you something. If you try to get filled with the Holy Ghost without getting the blood ahead of everything and get you cleansed, you can pick up the wrong thing. But I'll tell you what, I'm going to show you one day how to get the Holy Spirit and get it right. You won't get the wrong thing. Thank God you won't get the wrong thing. I'm sorry, my time's up. I better quit. I hope I didn't scare y'all too bad. No, I hope I scared y'all. Enough to get you changing.
Amen.
Let's do it right. The Lord is passing through. He's going to bring revival somewhere. But will you be able to bend it to the Shenandoah Valley?
Yes.
Remember that prophetic message was given on the Shenandoah Valley, that bend the Peak Mountain? Mm-hmm. Revival is coming to the Shenandoah Valley at the foot of Massanutten Peak. It'll spread throughout the world. Are we ready for the move of God? Are we ready for all these benches to be full, all these church things to be full? I'll tell you one thing. I'm not going to call this man's name because I'm just not going to call his name out. But I was in his church one day. And it's a strange thing. He gets up and said something that, man, I said, whoa, boy, that man's bold. He's got probably 1,500 people in his audience. He said, folks, when preaching is going on this morning now, nobody will be going to the restroom. If your bladder bursts, we'll pray for you after service. I thought, whoa, wee. There wasn't a soul went out that church, not a soul. You know what I'm wondering? Did we have to go back and start all over again? I was at a church one time, and I watched. While I was preaching, there's three and four people on the floor all the time I was preaching, either going to the restroom or coming out of the restroom. In the same church, they had Pepsi and Coke and potato chips and donuts and what have you. And the preacher's first set right in front of me eating potato chips and drinking their Coke or whatever it was while I'm preaching. I said, dear God in heaven, what am I doing here? What am I even here for? Well, I tell you what, those Coke and potato chips weren't long until those Cokes and potato chips had a revival. Maybe it's together, but I'll keep on going on. I'll tell you something about the time. Thank you.